That title is not clickbait. My Bamboo Labs X1 is broken! Last week it developed a problem where, between filament changes on a multicolor print, it kept saying that the filament cutter was stuck when it wasn't. And then, the following print I went to do, it just said that right off the bat and wouldn't start a print. Of course, just now I set up the camera and went to film it doing that yet again, and it worked fine. So clearly I have an intermittent problem here, and we are going to replace some parts to fix it. Also, I had a thermal runaway on this machine last week. Let me show you. I think we're having a thermal runaway. I can smell it burning. It says we're only 188 degrees Celsius, but there's smoke boiling off of the edge. Yeah, this thing is thermal running away. And it is not detecting that. Temperature's dropping. Temperature's dropping, but we are absolutely burning up. So, time to stop this and investigate. I just got the cover popped off the front, moved the print head to an area where I can actually access it. This is the thermistor plug, and it is seated. I changed the extruder assembly yesterday and I had to remove the hot end and then put it back in, but everything is plugged in and connected. That is plugged in. Oh, but it just updated temperature. 280. So this thing was pushing 300 plus degrees when it was just thermal runaway. And so that connection was bad or loose on the thermistor, and this thing did not pick up on it and did not thermal runaway protect. I did reach out to Bamboo support and they assure me this machine does have thermal runaway protection. I must have caught it before that it kicked in and shut things down. In my opinion, Marlin or Clipper would have caught that runaway sooner than this seemed like it was going to, if at all, but I can't say for sure. I can't say that it wasn't going to happen. It could have happened a split second after I stopped things. I don't know. Either way, the thermistor and the cutter issues both seem to be related to the tool head PCB, so Bamboo sent me a new one. We're gonna go ahead and replace that thing on this machine and do some other maintenance. This is also going to be a bit of a follow-up to my previous video on the X1 where I talked about it being a ringing beast. I have improved my results out of this machine substantially and I am much happier with it at this point. Still not all the way, but I'm going to show you how I improved it later on in this video. So let's get to work on repairing it. Replacement of this board in this machine is going to require basically tearing the entire tool head down. Bamboo did send me a link to a completely silent, kind of eerie video on how to disassemble and work on this. I don't know why a 5-minute long silent video makes me uncomfortable, but it did. Anyway, gonna start by removing the front cover and the wiring connection to it so I can get it out of the way. Now I need to disconnect all these connectors on this daughter board for the hot end and extruder assembly. Next, I gotta remove the screw for this cutter assembly. Pop that aside. Now I'm gonna remove the screws for the daughter board here and the reverse Bowden tube out of here. Anytime now, there we go. Now there are 4 screws on this rear housing, 2 on each side that I need to remove. With those out, I can remove this rear cover off of here. Then I need to remove the drag chain connection, just pull up on it. They show just pulling up on it. Down here in the corner is a USB-C connection, that is the power and data for the tool head. Now there are 4 more screws all around this piece of plastic that I need to remove so I can pop this off of here and get the board out. One last important thing before I pull the board out is this delicate little ribbon connector down here that I need to disconnect. Now I can disconnect these last couple of electrical connections and pull the screws out to remove this main tool head board. And now we're ready to pull this tool head PCB out of here with 1 more electrical connection on the back, of course. Oh, 2 more actually. And finally, with the tool head board out, you can see the actual stepper motor for the extruder. I think getting this board out of here is a good place for us to stop and have a quick discussion about the Bamboo printers and something that's been on my mind. In the last video, I think I likened the X1 to a home appliance in design philosophy. Now, as I'm taking all the little screws and interlocking plastic pieces and ribbon cables off, it feels more like a laptop computer versus a desktop computer to me. And that raises a question in my mind. Is this machine good for first-time 3D printers? I've seen a lot of people say this is their first 3D printer. I've seen a lot of people recommend it as a first 3D printer because of the push button and go experience. Bamboo has done a lot to round out the ecosystem with their own slicer, the AMS, everything the way it's integrated. They've gone far into creating a machine that's push button and go. The problem in my mind is, I think these machines are closer to a CNC milling machine than they are to your home printer. They can go a long way to making a well-rounded push button machine, but at the end of the day, all 3D printers will require maintenance and replacement of parts eventually. From what I've seen so far, Bamboo's support has been excellent about dispatching out parts to people and getting them the things they're gonna need to repair their machines, but they're 100% relying on you repairing your machine. There's a silent video and some guides on the wiki page about how to handle these replacements and repairs, but a lot of folks are gonna be intimidated by having to do any of this stuff. For me, as somebody who does product reviews and tutorials, I had to learn a long time ago to step back and stop applying all of my experience to the task at hand, because I have to think about the concept of somebody who's never done these things before having to do them and how they would approach them. And that's the thing I think a lot of people let color their opinion, is their own personal experience coming into a situation. Thinking about how this machine would work and how this would all look as somebody who has never worked on a 3D printer, a laptop, a gaming console, whatever, in the past, this would be intimidating, I think. And don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that anybody else is really doing it better than Bamboo at the moment. Try getting a hold of Creality to get some replacement parts for an Ender 3, let alone a guide on how to replace them. Prusa does have excellent support and guides on their website about how to replace things. They also now have the printed solid connection on the US side for sending machines in to get repaired. But I don't really know that anybody else in the consumer space is doing as good of a job as Bamboo. I'm just kind of raising some questions here. I don't know that I have the answers. Sorry. Let me know what you think in the comments down below. Does this seem like something you would have been able to take on your very first problem with your very first 3D printer? Reassembly is the reverse of the disassembly. It's pretty straightforward. You just have to be careful not to pinch any wires, and the Bamboo video does cover it. Also, my mainboard cooling fan doesn't sound too good. They did send me a replacement, but I'm gonna do that in another video where I'm gonna cover the replacement of a fan to make this thing quieter. For your information, this machine has about 450 hours on it at the moment. With the repairs out of the way, let's get to talking about fixing the ringing on this machine that I talked about in the previous video a few months ago. If you had asked me a week ago how exactly I improved the results out of this machine, I could have told you a straightforward path to doing it. Today, I have no idea. For this video, I printed three more Stealth Burner shrouds, the same model I used in the last video to demonstrate the issues I was running into. I did each one in a different way. One, I printed with the AMS sitting on top of the machine at the default 0.2mm profile. Another, I used the exact same G-code, but I took the AMS off the top of the machine. And then the third one, I used my own 0.2mm layer height quality preset that I created that makes speed changes, extrusion width changes, a couple other little tweaks to make strong and high quality parts. It's what I mostly use to print my Voron 2.4 and Project Reanimaker. I printed all three of them in different colors, but they are all Polymaker ASA, and I used a profile for that filament that I have tuned on this machine. And if I step back and look at all three of them, if it wasn't for the difference in color, I couldn't tell you which one is which. But the thing about it is, when I look at the old Stealth Burner that I printed in that previous video months ago, there is a clear difference. This has more ghosting, more ringing, more layer inconsistency than these new ones do. It's possible that they've made firmware or slicer changes that they haven't really publicized that have improved things here, or that my tuning of this filament and creating a specific profile tuned for this machine made this drastic of a difference. It's also entirely possible that I'm looking at these with kinder eyes than I was a few months ago. So I went to my Voron 2.4 that I only finished assembling about a week ago and had not printed anything on yet. I have only done the bare minimum of tuning on that machine, and I printed a Stealth Burner shroud that absolutely looks different than the ones on the X1. Now don't get me wrong, this shroud has some serious issues. I haven't tuned input shaper on that thing at all yet, so it has ghosting and ringing on this one as well, more aggressive than that of the X1 prints. It also has some serious layer lines in here where some extrusion inconsistencies are happening on top infill. But that's not what I want to focus on. What I want to look at is the corners on this print are so much crisper than those of the X1. It's so hard to translate this on camera and show you what I'm talking about, but when I touch them, I feel a drastic difference. The one printed on the Voron has these sharp corners that are really pronounced. The one printed on the X1, the corners are so rounded and soft. They feel like a stone at the bottom of a babbling brook that's been rounded by the ages. I'm being a little poetic and dramatic there, but there's just a big difference in the way these two feel in the hand. Last week, I thought the smoking gun was removing the AMS from the top of this machine because somebody in one of the Facebook groups had recommended doing that. And when I did, I saw an improvement in my prints going forward. But then today, running tests again, I'm not really seeing the difference anymore. I would say if you're really having ghosting and ringing issues on this machine, try it. Try removing the AMS off the top of it, rerun the vibration calibration on the machine, and then try again. See what results you're getting. I wish I had better answers for you folks. I just feel like Bamboo has focused too heavily on speed with this machine and not enough on quality. And that's not me saying it does bad prints, but I think it really has better quality capability in it, and they're just not focusing on getting it out of there. I get that in 3D printing right now, speed sells. But since I got this machine, they've only added one pre-setup profile to Bamboo Studio, and that was a 0.2 millimeter strength profile that all it really did was add a thicker shell on the print to make a stronger print. I wish, like Prusa does in Prusa Slicer, where they have for the Mark III a quality preset and a speed preset, I wish Bamboo would put that effort into this and give me a quality preset that's dialed in, even maybe reduces the vibration compensation for the slower speeds that's gonna be running, and would give me a crisper final result for those times where I just want that. Some prints I want done fast, some I want the best quality result I can get. Which for me, honestly, probably means I need to tune in my Voron 2.4 and get that thing printing a lot better. I think that'll end my rants for this one. I do have a video coming out in just a few days about reducing the sound of this machine by 20 decibels. So get subscribed if you're not already so you don't miss that one. I think that'll be a wrap on this one, folks. I hope you found this video interesting. If you did, please drop it a like. It really helps out. Let me know in the comments, did this help you see inside of this machine and how it's built a little bit better, or was it pointless? Let me know in the comments down below. Get subscribed so you don't miss any of the content coming down the road, and to ensure your 3D prints don't fail. It's not a guarantee, but it can't hurt.